If you look at notation, notation in statistics therefore turns out to be important, because you want to keep track of parameters that you really want to learn about, means and variances. But invariably, we are working with samples. So where you want to learn about a mu, we instead find ourselves an x bar. And where you wanted to learn about a sigma square, you learn about an s square and so on. But this also matters to us when we do regression. So for example, when you go back to this chemistry lab and you're doing this absorbance versus concentration experiment. So as you increase the concentration of a reactant in a tube, you want to figure out what's its absorbance, how much light does it absorb in a spectrometer. Okay. So it turns out, of course, there's, I don't know if you recall this theory here. There's a theory which interconnects absorbance and concentration. It's called Beer-Lambert's law. Okay, and Beer-Lambert's law basically says absorbance is proportional to concentration if you've got a dilute solution of particulates, right? So in that case, what Beer-Lambert's law is basically saying, y, which is absorbance, is proportional to x, which is concentration. So therefore, beta should be 0. There is no offset. So as I increase x, y will increase proportionately, and that alpha is some kind of inherent constant based on which species we have put in our test tube. So that's what, okay, Beer-Lambert's law says. Now, if I give you a reagent, let's say this is a protein whose color you're trying to estimate, whether you measure it or you measure it, you all should get the same value of alpha, because that is inherent to that molecule you're trying to evaluate. It cannot change. It cannot change from individual to individual. So it goes back to the fact that alpha is a parameter in a model. It's that inherent constant regardless of experiment, of regardless of trial. But that's not what works out when you do the experiment, you do the experiment. Will you get the same value of alpha? You will not. So is there a problem? There's no problem. There's no problem. It's like that coin toss, right? We are expecting 50 heads out of 100, but somebody sees 49, somebody else sees 51. Does it mean it's not a fair coin? So you can have variation around this true inherent constant. Therefore, that alpha, which should have been one precise value that everyone computed, is not going to be seen by everyone. You're going to get a range of values for alpha. And in fact, more precisely, what we end up estimating is AX plus B, where A is an estimate of alpha, B is an estimate of beta. And hopefully A is close enough to what anybody is claiming as a theoretical value. So for example, if you're evaluating acceleration due to gravity and trying to estimate the value of G, then you got to appreciate that you will never get 9.81. You will get some estimate. So that's why I'm putting this hat on top of G. We derive from our experiments an estimate somewhere close to 9.8, but that's okay. I mean, it's okay that we are not precisely there. So think again of this coin toss. I would be extremely surprised and very nervous if all of you got 50 heads out of 100. Because that's actually reflective of a bias in how you have performed the experiments. Okay? And I'm not trying to use the word manipulate. So I'm just simply saying bias. Okay? So, if you then think about it, all these things that we observe are estimates of the true fundamental parameters that the model, the physics, the model suggests. So we sample therefore to kind of draw conclusions about an entire population. Okay. The population can be described by probability distributions. Samples give us measurements following a distribution, and we assume that the samples are randomly chosen. All these things go back to that coin toss. Why did we like that coin toss to start games? So you know the set of outcomes, you couldn't predict the precise outcome. Okay. So now, should I be looking at individual measurements or should I be looking at arithmetic mean? So that x bar is my notation for an arithmetic mean. So a fair amount of time in this data analysis course goes into convincing people, don't look at individual measurements. Never look at individuals. Look at averages. Replicate, look at averages. And why is there an advantage to looking at averages? That advantage is because of the variance associated with an average. If I look at you and I say that you are representative of the average human height, your height will be chosen to represent the average human height, and then I go and look at somebody else separately, I do not learn anything new. I'm not able to converge. If there's so much variation associated with the measurement of your height, that variation exists with the measurement of your height. So I'm not able to zoom in and work out what's the true average height. But the moment I start working with averages, the beauty here is, as I increase my number of samples, you can see that n in the denominator, as I increase my number of samples, my variance drops. What do you mean variance drops? We are converging to a mean value. So if I look at individual measurements, I do not learn new things. If I look at averages, I start learning new things and I start getting more and more confident about the true underlying value, which is at the heart of why we intuitively think of replicating results. Okay. And I'll just show this to you in the context of, it's a statistics discussion. You can't avoid looking at graphs like these or plots like this. Okay. So inherently what this is saying is, when you're looking at only one measurement, and this is supposed to be the true value you're trying to get, let's say that 9.8, then there's a large range of outcomes you might see associated with this curve. There's a very large range of outcomes you might see. But the moment I start doing replicates, if I'm trying to find 9.8, then my distribution starts getting narrower and narrower. Okay? And therefore, if I'm now looking at a window around my mean, that window is shrinking. Okay, so think of that window as some kind of an error bar. That error bar, which I'm going to use to represent my uncertainty in my measurement, that's shrinking. So as obviously as n goes to infinity, this actually becomes one delta function. It actually becomes a peak. You're absolutely confident. Okay. So this is one of the key theorems in statistics, which tells you that basically, sorry, with more and more samples. So as I increase the number of measurements and replicates basically, I start learning more. Okay. So if I come back to now this notion of a hypothesis test and I make a connection to humanities or philosophy, this actually goes back to a guy who's dominated over the last, again, 50 years. And his theory here of the mode of research is something called critical rationalism. There's a lot you can learn about this. You can, for instance, just start off with Wikipedia and then look up a lot of associated links there. And he basically says it's very hard to prove something true. And this point was made to you on the first day. In any research methodology, we feel it's very hard to prove something true. And in fact, it's much easier for us to set it up as a test of failure. In other words, we try to prove something false, because it's much easier to show a counterexample and prove something's false than to prove something's true. And this affects us tremendously in the way we go about doing research. In fact, when you apply for funds to a government agency, they'll actually probably want you to write a question so that there are narrow experiments which you can do to prove or disprove, more likely disprove something. Okay. So if you want an example to think of this, let's say that you have, again, let's go back to this scientist who has come up with a new drug candidate in the lab. So you think it's a new drug for cancer. You think it's a great drug. So how do you prove it's a great drug? You've got to go do trials, you've got to test it on people, on patients, and then prove. Now, how many samples must you do to prove that it's a drug? A very large number. So what's the easy way out? Because pharma companies, and by the way, a new drug costs a pharma company about $1 billion. I told you they hire statisticians, because if they can cut down on the number of experiments they do at $1 billion per drug in R&D, you can see the impact of doing good data analysis. So what they do is, instead of asking how do we prove that the molecule is a new great drug, you do something very silly, seemingly silly. You prove that the molecule is not the same as a sugar pill. So do you see that? What you should have been doing is proving that your molecule functions as a nice active chemical agent. But instead, we set up a hypothesis that the molecule that we have just invented is as good as a sugar pill. A sugar pill, by the way, is called a placebo. Okay? And then what do you do? you actually try and prove that it's not as good as a sugar pill, therefore indirectly implying that it's better than a sugar pill. But you see, the entire spotlight is on proving or disproving equivalence to a sugar pill, and the spotlight is not on proving that this molecule is a fancy drug. It's a neat trick. But it's a trick which has impacted us in terms of even our legal system. Think about it. Think about it. What? How does our legal system work? Innocent until proven guilty. So it's a hypothesis test. Why should we go with innocence unless proven guilty? Why not directly prove guilt? Because you can see how that trial will go. You will try to find something, some wrong or the other that somebody has done, and you will be able to nail anybody. So everyone's finally going to be shown guilty of whatever it is. You'll pull out something from their childhood and say that they're guilty. Right? So it actually impacts how we've gone about this. So the basic notion is that you're innocent, and therefore the burden of proof is put on the prosecution to prove that you're guilty. It's a related argument here. It's easier to prove a falsehood than the truth directly. And that's how our science is done. So we in fact focus on setting up small statements which you can prove false. Of course, if I prove that my molecule is not the same as a sugar pill, it doesn't tell me how much more active it is. And for example, is my antibiotic, new antibiotic better than an existing antibiotic? I don't learn that. In fact, that I have to take up as a next question. It's not. It's not. If you now, that's why I said this is a very fuzzy philosophical area. But it inherently reflects the fact that it takes us a lot of examples or experiments, therefore, to try and prove a truth. Because all I have to do is to find one counterexample. We say that all crows are black. I just have to go there and find one white crow. Right? So it's easier for us to overturn a statement than to keep proving that all crows are black. Because what does it take for me to do that? I'll have to go sample every single crow and then end up concluding that all crows are black.
If I define crow as only black?
No, but but then how are you going to proceed with an experimental design? So what are you going to do about it next? You either have to go and sample all crows.
How
are
you defining the crow then?
No, so the hypothesis is that crows are black. Okay, so the test for that is, there are two approaches. Either I go and identify every single crow, which is obviously not doable. Yeah, now we're getting into something even more fuzzy in terms of philosophy. So we're trying to stay away from that. I just want you to point out, okay? I just want you to point out that this idea that it's easier to tackle a falsehood actually dominates how we do our statistics. Because we take small questions which we try to prove or disprove. Okay, so we these days design experiments with falsifiable hypothesis. Okay. The other approach would have been inductive reasoning. You keep seeing more and more evidence, and you induce from there what you think the behavior is. If I keep seeing a drug work on a set of people, then the belief is that it will continue working on more people. This, for example, is our traditional Ayurvedic style of treatments, for instance. And the reason it's not too popular these days in science is because then that requires that you keep testing for more and more crows to be black. You need more and more experiments. It seems to be a lot more work. So the procedure then, to summarize, is that to test a hypothesis pertaining to a population parameter, we set up a model, we identify the parameters in the model, and now need to devise a test, and it goes back to this range. So if I'm going to prove a hypothesis, if I'm going to prove that my drug is better than a sugar pill, so what's the trick? If I want to prove that my drug is better than a sugar pill, I do not put the spotlight on the drug. Instead, I put the spotlight on the drug being the same as a sugar pill. And then I try to prove that that statement is false. So if the drug is same as the sugar pill, the difference in performance of the drug from the sugar pill is this. So we'll assume that that zero point maps onto drug being equal to sugar pill. Okay. So then it's like that coin toss. We expected 50 heads. Okay. In fact, it's easier to give you a coin toss analogy here. So at what point will you say that the coin is not fair? when you see two extreme result, either less than, let's say, 20 heads or more than 80 heads. So there's got to be this range. There's got to be this range where you will say, within this interval, any measurement that I see, or any average for that matter, we said we'll work with averages, any average that we see is reflective of the true value. In other words, we should on average have seen this, but we're seeing values here, but a value here is equivalent to this. So that's the statement. A value here is equivalent to that. And the reason it's not exactly that is because of my imprecision in sampling. And the fact is inherent randomness in how I'm sampling. Okay, so I've got to acknowledge that I've got imprecision. So that sets up for me a range. That range is where my null hypothesis, and what was my null hypothesis? Drug equals sugar pill. That's where the null hypothesis is accepted. Actually, we don't like saying accepted. Remember what we were trying to do? We were trying to prove a statement false. Okay, so the fact that I get a measurement in this range actually doesn't prove that it does not prove that the drug is a sugar pill. It means, again, notice the trickery here, it means that I failed to disprove that the drug was different from a sugar pill. I don't have enough evidence to say that my drug is different from a sugar pill because my measurements for the drug seem to be close enough to the measurements for the sugar pill. Slight trickery. In other words, we are being a little grudging. We don't want to accept that the drug is a sugar pill. We don't want that. And why did we not want that? Because we are a pharma company trying to make a profit selling a drug. We really want the drug to work out, to be different. So you can see how the whole research approach is being tweaked around. We do not want to tackle the question directly. So we are framing a falsehood. We frame a falsehood hoping what? Hoping that our measurements will lie outside, somewhere far, so that we can say that drug is tremendously different from a sugar pill. That's what we are hoping for. And when it doesn't happen, when we end up here, rather than say our drug didn't work out, we will simply say we did not have enough evidence to disprove the null hypothesis. So we are not accepting the null hypothesis. We have not been able to disprove the null hypothesis.
So when we say the drug is not same as sugar pill, how does that prove that it is better than sugar pill?
It doesn't. Again, it can be. So it could be on that side. Okay. So you can see the trickery in this. And all of this because it's possible for us to do a few experiments and then very quickly figure out where do we stand relative to a claim. There's also a subtle thing which happened here. We said the drug equals a sugar pill. Okay, so now it comes to that. If instead I had said, let's try to prove my drug is better than a sugar pill, then I'd have been stuck with a follow-up question. How much better? Because then, if I was saying that the drug is better than a sugar pill, and here's where my sugar pill is, I would have had to ask, where do I now expect my drug to show up? Does it show up here, or here, or here? So define what you mean by better. And we don't want that, because that's a tricky business. So even if you are 1% better than a sugar pill, we are going to advertise tomorrow and say we have found a super duper drug which will do the job. Fine? So the whole analysis procedure gets tweaked around because you want convenience in experimentation and you want to avoid large numbers of samples in your instrumentation. So this is a point I'd made a little earlier. Remove the IQ. Rural versus urban. Okay. So in all of this, in what follows, I want you to appreciate again a major insight into statistics is statistics cannot counter a badly designed scientific question. You want to answer, is a drug better than a sugar pill? There's a way for that. There's a statistical algorithm for that. Should you have been comparing that particular drug with that sugar pill? I don't know. That's for a chemist or a pharmacist to kind of explain why that molecule must be studied. Okay, and the statistician knows none of that. So if you therefore now try to summarize what we have just described as a procedure, what's the typical approach that we follow in methodology for involving statistics in this? We start by stating a hypothesis. Actually, we state two hypotheses. We state a hypothesis as an equality, drug equals sugar pill. Right? But why did we even do that? because we wanted to prove that the drug was good. So in other words, our real belief, what we want to succeed, is an alternate hypothesis that the drug is better than a sugar pill. That's where we are. But because we do not want that to be tackled up front, we focus on an equality, and that equality allows us to prove that we are slightly better than it easily. Okay, so state the hypothesis. Identify a random variable involved and the relevant parameter to be tested. So the moment we are saying we are going to start looking at drugs, so what is the measurement? For example, if it's a BP drug, I'll have to start measuring people's BPs. Those have taken the drug, those have been taking the sugar pill. So that's going to be my variable. So identify that measurement, which is going to be tested. Okay. Clearly state the hypothesis. So H naught is what we want to. Okay, here's a trick. The pharma company does not want H naught to win. The pharma company wants H1 to win, but we shoot down H naught. Okay. So identify how H naught is expected to describe variation. In other words, our measurements are not going to be precise. Our measurements have error in them. You can expect a range of results. So if you're going to make a claim about truth or falsehood, that's relative to our ability to correctly do an experiment. So how much error might we have? What's that uncertainty with our measurements? And therefore, intuitively, if our measurements are very precise, we should really be able to distinguish a drug from a sugar pill. But if our BP measuring device, you know those devices that they wrap around, if that measuring device itself has a huge least count, then do you really have the ability to distinguish a drug from a sugar pill? So it's a function of your measurement errors. So therefore, we need to understand the distribution that applies and the variance in particular that's associated with your measurements. So we then identify a significance level. Okay, when I drew that distribution for you and I said, here's an interval, okay, there was a certain area outside it. Do you want that area outside it to be very small, in which case you are setting the goalposts even further wide apart? And it's very hard for you to now shoot down H naught, because anything inside the goalpost means H naught is okay. Drug equals sugar pill. So you want a narrow set of goalposts, because then it's easier for you to shoot down H naught. So what's that area outside? Identify the threshold, which we'll use to decide on the test. Okay. The relevant distribution is to be identified. So we'll get into this as we do the actual workshop as to what are the procedural details in carrying out these steps. Are we looking at one side of the table, of the distribution, or are we looking at both sides? So that's what I mean by one-sided, two-sided. Okay. And compute the test statistic from sample data. Just one subtle thing here. The first appearance of our measurements from our experiments in the entire approach is in step 4. You do not do an experiment, you do not collect data, and then go back and ask where should the goalpost be. If I want to prove that the drug is a sugar pill, is better than a sugar pill, I should not get my measurements and then figure out where to keep the goalpost, because I am biased. Remember, I am a pharma company here trying to sell my drug. So I want that drug to work, turn out to be better than a sugar pill. So I'll make sure I'll set the goalpost such that the sugar pill looks far inferior to the drug. So you can't do that. That's cheating, obviously. So the goalposts have to be defined first, and then you ask, where did our measurements end up? Are we inside or outside? And if you're outside, we say you've got something funny or extreme going on. So these are subtle ways. So this procedure is written out, and I describe in the data analysis course in detail what happens if you interchange steps. Where is the possibility for cheating in here? Yes. Okay. So what are the issues with the procedure steps, and how does one kind of compromise the procedure by doing things out of sequence? They are typically negations of each other, but that's also a kind of problematic thing. So for example, what is the complement of drug equals sugar pill? Look at the pharma company. If it was a BP drug for BP, what did you expect? The BP, the change in BP should be, it should control your BP better than the sugar pill does. So in other words, we are expecting BP measurements to lie on one side, not randomly on both sides of what the sugar pill does. So the opposite of drug equals sugar pill could have been drug either not equal to sugar pill, or drug better than sugar pill, or drug worse than sugar pill. These are all possibilities for you. They are not direct negation. So it comes down to, again, precisely what you have in mind. Are you expecting? For example, somebody is trying to sell you a set of light bulbs and claims that your light bulbs last 500 hours, right? And you decide to do a test. You're going to buy light bulbs and figure out the average lifespan of a bulb. Now, what do you think? Do you think your light bulbs will on average last 500 hours? More or less? Where do you expect your measurements to be? Less, because you expect this guy to have already inflated the estimate of 500. You don't trust that 500. That's why you're doing a test in the first place. That's why you're investing your money in buying light bulbs. So at the end of it all, you don't expect measurements to lie much above 500, because if you end up with working out an average of 600 hours per light bulb, that fellow will be going to be very grateful to you to proving that his bulbs are good. So if anything, you expect him to inflate it. That's what we do in advertising. You inflate a claim, which implies therefore that you expect measurements at a lower end. So we want our attention therefore focused on the lower end. Okay. Finally, there's a systematic way in which you report a test result. And there's a concept called p-value, which is critical to reporting these results. And you also want to talk about how powerful as in a numerical estimate of the power of a test. So these are concepts that one describes in detail in a hypothesis testing course. So before we break for tea, I just want you to appreciate that life is not as simple as what I just put up. And the reason is probability, as we have talked about it, has been talked about in the context of a repeatable experiment. So we talked about coin tosses, and you have no problem tossing your coin 100 times. Your thumbs will hurt, but you can toss it 100 times and you can see yourself doing that experiment. But supposing I asked you to prove that increased CO2 levels will cause the polar ice cap to melt. Okay, increasing the CO2 levels will cause the ice at the North Pole to melt. Can you repeat that experiment? No. So we have a fundamental problem. So we still want to test such hypotheses. And you can see, obviously, in climate science, these are very important hypotheses. So now it comes down to not so much probability based on frequency of an occurrence. So when you talked about coin toss, the frequency of heads over all possible tosses. So it is a frequency-based definition. Now we've got to talk about belief-based definitions. Because we have, for example, with that crow example, we have a certain belief that crows are black. And then that belief system will change based on which crow we see. If I see more black crows, my belief that crows are black will only increase. On the other hand, if I see a white crow, boom, my belief system changes tremendously. Okay, so there's this notion of belief, and that takes us back to Bayes' theorem. Hopefully some of you recall Bayes' theorem. Okay, the way it would have been taught to you is probability of A given B in terms of probability of B given A. But we have now got to talk about probability of a model. So the model could be crows being black. The probability of crows being black, given that I've seen a new crow who is black, what is that now? That's got to be written in terms of the probability of a model before. So here's how this gets interpreted. Before I did any experiment, I had a belief in crows being black. And then I went and got myself some data. I did some experiments, I got myself some data. I caught some crows and I looked at their color. And having seen the data, I've got to update my belief. So that term on the left-hand side is almost like an update. You had a previous belief, you see some data, and now you have an update on what's going on. Okay, so there is this approach called the Bayesian approach, as opposed to a frequency-based approach of how you interpret probabilities and therefore beliefs. And research is a lot like that, because we don't think we have got a precise model that we can do infinite sampling and then work out parameters in a model. It's almost like a belief. So there's a certain belief in Newtonian physics. And your belief in Newtonian physics is going to be shaken the moment you see one example which can't be explained using Newtonian physics. And then you need Einstein and his theory of relativity. So it's a belief system. So given, for example, two competing theories, you're going to have beliefs in both theories. And our tendency is to go with a simpler theory which explains all that we've seen, right? So therefore, the belief now that's being shared by two theories which are competing with each other kind of gets modified based on the data we have just seen. And if the data tends to say that one theory therefore ought to gain more weightage or belief or credence, then we put our belief now in this new theory compared to the other theory. Okay, so in the Bayesian world, It's not like saying there's only one theory. So if you thought of that hypothesis test, we had sugar pill equal drug. That was one narrow question, and that's that. And you disprove it. Disproving it then gives you a gray area. What are you going to do about it? So if it turns out your drug is different from a sugar pill, what does it mean? You'll have to do something more to explain what it means. So in the Bayesian world, you end up saying there are multiple theories possible. And now it's about how much do you believe in each of these theories. So that average human height could have been 3 feet, could have been 5 feet, could have been 7 feet. And as that alien sees more and more human beings, the belief in the average human height being 7 will drop down, 5 drop down, and 3 goes up. So you have multiple models, multiple theories, and we are now talking about juggling the extents of belief in each of these theories. So that's a Bayesian world. That's important to us because we are doing things in incremental bits. Okay, so when you're talking about doing experiments, they're adding or removing belief in a particular model system. So there's a strong conditional probability based explanation of how we go about that. Okay, so that of course now impacts that hypothesis test. So if I told you that I want to simultaneously believe in crows being black and crows not being black, and I just want to juggle the extent of belief in these two models based on available data, that's a different way to go about it than simply saying crows are black and then trying to go with a set of measurements. Because when I say the later case, crows are black, I acknowledge only one model at a time. Okay? Otherwise, I can think of beliefs in multiple models. Okay, so we'll pause here for our tea, and when we get back, we'll start discussing about ways of representing data and how one can be more efficient in conveying information with data presentation. And after that, we start talking of a key distinction between cause and effect, because that's also a key aspect of research. What I will do is give you a flavor for three additional topics, and we'll have to kind of leave the discussion of the actual topics for the main workshop later in the month. Now, what I'm going to do in the next topic is point out to you that it's important to convey this information precisely to others. So, it's usually a discussion of descriptive statistics, but I'm going to forget the descriptive part, and we're just going to point out statistics using pictures. And I just want you to be aware that, over the years, this has taken on a different dimension in terms of how you can convey information fast. Of course, don't forget this point which was brought out in one of the videos you saw on the first day, which is you must talk about numerical significance. It's very annoying to see students take some measurement, let's say 1.0, and then divide it by another measurement, 3.0, and say that 1.0 divided by 3.0 is 0.333333, just because the calculator gives you 10 digits. You've got to talk in terms of the number of significant digits and the least count, invariably of your measurements defines the number of significant digits. You've got to then persevere with all subsequent calculations with the same number of digits. You suddenly cannot get something more precise to infinite digits just because your calculator tells you that. Your calculator is not aware of errors and how errors propagate. Okay, so it's a key aspect which governs, therefore, these intervals of uncertainty, which anyway were what we were talking just before the break with the hypothesis test. It's something that's particularly annoying when students tend to do this in labs. So it's something that we'll discuss in the main workshop in some detail. Okay, but I instead want to focus on the fact that we are all used to certain ways of depicting data. So the bar graph, the line chart, the polygon, and the fact that we need to be maintaining data in tabular form. So if you think about it, most of this has to do with the fact that given tons of data, you can't really walk around with data. You have how many significant digits in 1.0? Two significant digits, because the one was important to you and the zero was important to you. Okay, in other words, you don't trust the follow-up digit, 1.05. You don't know about that 5. Right? So if you've got two significant digits, you have two significant digits in your answer. That's it. Okay, so 0.3. Yes. How many significant digits? Yeah, so accuracy gets lost when you do a series of calculations. For example, when you subtract, if I were to tell you take 0.33 and subtract 0.31, you've lost significance because you've now got one significant digit. Your answer is 0.02, 0.33 minus 0.31, 0.02, but only the two matters to you. So you've gone down to a significant digit. Okay. So you can sit and work this out. In other words, you can simulate what might happen at the next place and then work out the range of answers that you get. And so a fairly important aspect is that as you go through your calculations, you tend to lose significance.
Can I put it differently? I have something iterated into a slight degree. And if I use an accurate weighing machine to measure, I'll get how many significance.
No, the point is this. If you've got a certain number of significant digits, and typically the least count of whatever you're using tells you that, okay, you can't do better than that. And if you've got one measurement which is inaccurate, and that's entering into a formula with many calculations, it doesn't matter that the other things were measured to high precision. This guy, which is inaccurate, is going to impact the accuracy of your final product. Okay, and so that has to be taken into account. So that's invariably ignored because calculators report for you a set number of digits.
Measure exactly 1 kg, measure exactly 3%. So one kg divided into 3 equal parts.
No, there if you're implying that your 1 is to infinite precision, and then you're dividing by 3 people, and 3 obviously is infinite
hello.
In terms of precision because it's an integer, then you've got infinite precision.
1 kg
precisely split into 3 has infinite precision, but a 1.0 divided by 3 has its problems. Okay, so coming back to this, the whole point of this is given tons of data, we've got to find quick ways of compressing it and carrying it around. We can't carry matrices of data, so we want plots. We want to learn things from plots. So when you're talking about the distribution of heights, what's the average, what's the range? Is it a skewed distribution? Are we a room full of tall people versus short people? So all of that information is easily conveyed using some kind of a curve or a plot. Okay, and invariably, we want to abstract out these plots or these functions from the whole matrix of data. So that's where this notion of descriptive statistics starts. Okay, so these are the classical ways of doing it. Here's a waterfall chart. You start with 217, then something subtracts out 55, then you add back up and you can see the levels going up and down. And you can look at the final 199. So these are just different tricks with how do you want to convey information of addition and decrease. There's a stem and leaf plot, which your textbooks, statistics books say, here's a way to represent numbers. So that's a 70.0, a 69.0, do you see that? Okay, the common digit is abstracted out and written to the left in the margin. Okay, so if I've got 51.0, 51.3 and so on, then rather than repeat the 5 all the time, pull out the 5. And this now starts looking like a leaf. But these were things invented way back when all we had was typewriters to convey information in plots. We can do much better. Okay. So of course, nowadays, thanks to Scilab, hopefully all of you appreciated the workshop on Scilab. Okay, there are ways to now handle lots of data and come up with elegant plots to convey trends. Here's actually something out of biology where, okay, for different patients, you're looking at the level of production of a protein, and the idea is to figure out, is there some defect in protein production in a patient? So it's called a heat map. There's a pie chart. Okay, the first pie chart was ironically by a nurse. Remember Florence Nightingale, lady with the lamp? She was trying to make a simple point, again back to the politicians in England. She wanted to say that there were more soldiers dying in the war zone because of lack of hygiene and because of enemy bullets. So she just looked at mortality, how many were dying per month, and here's a way of conveying it back. So it's a simple, elegant idea. The same thing can be drawn in different ways. Now here's an unusual way to think of the sizes of continents, and so here's Africa with different countries plugged in there. Do you see China? Do you see the US? Do you see India plugged in here? Okay, so it gives you an impact now of what's going on in terms of comparative behavior. Here's a periodic table in a form you have not seen. Okay, so the idea is to provoke. The idea is to communicate and inform. Okay, you can start provoking with different representations. Okay, these are called Chernoff faces used in pattern recognition. And if you've got, remember I told you about that a nuclear plant operator who's trying to stare at 100 different sensors at a time, so he's getting some readouts, some signals fluctuating back and forth. He wants to make sense fast. So it turns out one quick way to do this is to take each measurement and assign it to some part of the face. So your eye, the shape of your eye, or shape of your eyelid, okay, whether you're smiling or not. So the process is a good process. Hopefully you're somewhere over here, a small smile. Why is it important? Because you map the variable to some facial feature. It's easy for us to recognize the facial feature and recognize things are fine. So very intuitively, it quickly tells you, you don't have to do the calculations. You don't need formulae. It tells you one look at this image and you're learning a lot about your process. So it's just a trick. Okay. So each of these lines you see is a different variable actually. So the magnitude of the variable depicts the magnitude of the line. Here's the world map drawn according to population. You see China and India dominate, the other countries do not. So just ways to be provocative. And that said, you really ought to go and look at this site, gapminder.org. Or you could go to ted.com and look up a chap called Hans Rosling, who's essentially founded this company. He's basically a health scientist. And he's been trying to talk of how, okay, there have been tremendous changes to various third world countries over the last 30, 40 years in terms of how health has improved, mortality has improved. Okay, beautiful insights, beautiful insights. He's got essentially a tool which looks like this, except it's animated. Okay. Yeah, so that would have been gapminder.org or ted.com, and the name is Hans Rosling. And so he's basically got this tool, and there's lots of data which the World Health Organization has collected over the years, and essentially runs an animation, so a video of what happens over the years. So his bubbles move around. Okay, you scroll this back to 1960 and you start a video, and then you realize what's gone on in the world. So the history of the world, boom, in 10 seconds, the amount of information he conveys with this is staggering. So basically, he's trying to point out how countries like India and China start at this end, very little money, very poor health, as in the health is measured in terms of life expectancy, so very low health. And how are we all moving towards Japan and the US? And you're not doing as badly as we think we are, so you're moving well. And you learn some surprising insights. China, for instance, controlled its population first, right, before becoming rich. So boom, they went up there, they improved their life expectancy, then they're becoming rich. So he's got tools like this, which allow you to look at various parameters. So this is a function now of the United Nations giving data out there, census derived data out there. And so you can play around with this, and it impacts now policy in big ways. Okay, Google has a similar tool for this now, which is open source, which you can play around with this, Public Data Explorer. So point of it is there are now much more sophisticated ways of making data, okay, felt in terms of a presentation to others, as opposed to the standard cartoons that you see in your statistics books. So you don't really need the bar plot anymore or a frequency polygon anymore, if you can help it. There's also this standard cartoon that I put up, which is that we need information to bring down confusion, but if you have too much information, you can actually confuse people. So you've got to tailor your presentations of the data that you have. The things that you can do, you can plot this data, you can learn how to deal with data in spreadsheets. Okay. And of course, you can also learn how to do it in Scilab. We'll do some of that in the course. Now, in what little time I have left, I want to bring up one important serious topic, okay, which has to do with cause and effect. And again, I want to, just like we had talked about the hypothesis test before the break, I want to bring out that we tend to confuse, okay, the notion of cause and effect given the data. So you can look up this particular phrase on Google and you'll get a set of presentations created by a guy called Judea Pearl. Judea Pearl is actually more famous for his son, a guy called Daniel Pearl, who some of you might remember as that American journalist killed in Pakistan. Okay, so the cause of, so he's one of the leading researchers in causality, okay, that too from a computer science perspective. Okay, and unfortunately, thanks to his son being killed off, he's given up all his research. There's lots of interesting presentations that he gives about the history of this kind of research methodology. And since we're talking of methodology, it's important that you get a sense of this. And you'll appreciate that really we want to make statements about causality. Something is causing something. This drug causes that symptom to go away. We want causality. Okay. Smoking causes cancer. Okay. But the catch is, whatever experimentation you do only proves correlations between variables. So you take a bunch of people, you'll realize that they have been smoking and that they have cancer. So there is now a relationship between X and Y, that's a correlation. What it doesn't tell you is that smoking causes cancer. That's the theory we would like to believe. That's the theory which inherently we think is true. But it's subtlety that I want to point out to you. When you say Y equals AX plus B, you're saying that Y is related to X. But think of all the years where you have been asked how to plot in your high school. You've been told put X on the X-axis, the lower axis, and Y on the vertical axis, right? You've been told to do that. The interpretation being, you're in charge of X, you control X, and then you will see what happens to Y. So in other words, you've got an independent variable and a dependent variable. Something depends on something else. So X is the cause, Y is the effect, right? But there's a subtle thing about that, which is, if you're insisting that Y equals AX plus B, I should be able to rearrange that algebraic expression and write X as a function of Y. But then what is cause and what is effect? Okay, so the key thing here is, in math, we do not, in an immediate sense, have a notation to deal with causality. So we have an equality sign. That equality sign only tells us there's a relationship between Y and X, but it does not tell us that Y is caused by X, and it does not tell us that X is caused by Y. It simply says that you change X, Y changes, and vice versa. Whereas in causality, we want an arrow. We want to say X causes Y. That's a subtle thing. So when we do our research and we say, let's go about and in our process, make 10 measurements, we'll quickly realize that some things seem to be changing along with some other variables. And therefore, you're now tempted to say there's a relationship between these variables. And there's one quick thing that we jump and claim, which is that variable X caused variable Y. But how do we know that? Okay. So the extent of smoking seems to be associated with the extent of cancer that people, or with the incidence of cancer. But think of the interpretation. Does smoking cause cancer, or do people with cancer smoke? And why is that not feasible as a theory? So we have more preference to one particular direction of this arrow than the other. But there's no proof. You are unable to prove that direction. Okay? You are unable to prove it until you do an additional experiment. And I'll discuss that in a little bit. Okay, by the way, I just want to show you this. Can you ever think of you're asked to plot Y versus X? So it's a standard interview question that I have when I interview students. Can you interchange the plot and plot X on the Y axis and Y on the X axis?
In thermodynamics, you do that.
Yeah, in thermodynamics, you have to do it. Okay, but it's a skill. It's in fact a failing of a schooling system that you're taught to visualize things in a fixed format. You tend to visualize process, for example, a saturating process like this. Could it have been saturating like this? Okay, so it's one of those issues. You've got to figure out how to visualize, okay, relationships between variables and not get locked into a bias in one form or the other. So it turns out many people have struggled with this. Okay. Galileo, of course, started shaking things up. And then later on, it turns out many laws that we have developed are empirical laws, okay, in causality. And the first guy who really starts talking about causality is a guy called Hume, who looks at flame and heat and says, where there's a flame, there's heat. Okay, and he's trying to imply that, okay, you can learn these rules. And that's the first instance where you get a sense that one can look at data and learn a rule. Learn a rule which says something's causing something else. Okay. Of course, you got problems. The crowing rooster and sunrise. What's causing what? You can see the philosophical tangle you get into. All you know is that the two happen at the same time, but what's causing what? Okay. Similarly, when you've given an expression like this, you'll realize that given two quantities, you'll be able to solve for the third. But does that mean force is caused by acceleration? Or is acceleration caused by force? Because if you think about how we are taught in physics, acceleration is actually caused by something propelling an object, right? So force being applied. So it's a subtle thing. But does the equation tell you that? It doesn't. Okay. For that matter, can you rearrange it to say F by A causes mass? So that causality is a big headache. Okay. And then another major statistician comes along in the early 1900s and talks about correlation and not causation. keep focusing on relationships, prove that the pairwise relationships, show that X and Y are related by some linear model, Y is proportional to X, but don't go that extra step and claim causation because you don't have proof. Okay? And it then turns out that if you want to prove X is causing Y, if you want to prove that smoking causes cancer, you got to do some additional experiments. Okay? And a simple example to prove this. If you take the equivalent relationships y equals 2x and z equals y plus 1 and x equals y by 2 and y equals z minus 1. So, I am just playing around with this. You will realize that they are the same expressions. Okay. They will automatically imply that the two statements are identical. You can go, okay. I am just kind of rushing through this, but you can take it for granted that the two statements are identical. If I plug in the original equations, you will get that. But if you think about it now, if I want to show arrows, how do I go about it? To go from x to y in the top model, should over here, what should I have been doing? Should I have been multiplying, okay, by some parameter into 2 and then adding 1. So, the into 2 gives me y. So, y equals 2x and z equals 1 plus y. That is the interpretation. And similarly, if z is what is causing everything in my model, I have got to interpret it slightly different. So, it is a subtle thing. But how do I know which one is true? I'll see values of x, I'll see values of y, I'll see values of z as I do my experiments for different combinations of x and y and z. So, how do I know which model is true? You can't do this until you intervene and do something critical. For example, suppose if you come in here and say, regardless of whether y came from x or not, let's somehow fix y, set y equals 0. Let's force y to be 0. If you force y to be 0, what should happen? According to this upper model, what should happen if y is 0? It means z is 0. All the time, regardless of what happens with x. Sorry, z is 1, regardless of what happens with x. But in the according to the lower model, what should happen if y is 0? X is 0, regardless of what happens with z. So now do you see, if I intervene and set y equals 0 and then I observe x and z, I can figure out which way my arrows are going. So that's the basic idea of an intervention experiment. So, invariably, when you do experiments and you learn that so many variables are related to each other, what next? How do you figure out what's causing what? You have to go fix some variables, and then as soon as you fix some variables, you got to ask what else will change. And that gives you an idea of which way things are headed. Okay. Just to get a sense of how controversial this can be, I've just put a couple of examples here and we'll end with these examples. So, if you go back to a major publication in the Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences in the US, there's an article which came out a couple of years back on warming increasing the risk of civil war. So, this is not really about causality directly, but the fact that sometimes interpretations can be false or could potentially be false and therefore dangerous. So, here's a statement which says warming increases the risk of civil war in Africa. And if you go through the paper, they are saying that years which are likely to be very warm years in Africa, the US and the UN should not pump in money as aid into Africa because people are going to fight anyway and they're going to waste the resources. So that's the impact of the statement. So you can see there's big money at stake for countries in Africa. How did they come up with this? They simply looked at the average temperature on the continent versus the frequency of wars, and there's a correlation. There's a relationship between the temperature and wars. And from there, they're jumping to saying warming causes wars. Causality, it's the warming which caused a war or causes wars. Now, there could be an elaborate reason. Warming, hot years, you run out of water. You run out of water, you're more likely to beat up your neighbor. And wars will happen. So, there could be a realistic physical reason why this is happening. But the experiment is not done to prove that linkage. Net result, it did impact funding, humanitarian funding to Africa. Okay. So, this can be controversial. Of course, there's been a lot of follow-up on this in the policy literature debating such things. Here's another thing which created a lot of fuss, had to do with cricket. So, do you remember Javed Miandad and the famous six at Sharjah? So, here's a guy who published in a medical journal in England that after that six, in 1986, that Pakistan started winning relative to years before, started winning against India. So, what you are looking at is the net cumulative wins that Pakistan had. So they were trying to imply that that six was a defining moment in cricket. After that, at least up till the early 2000s, that Pakistan had a winning streak against India. That's also a flawed argument. You can immediately imagine cricket, right? India, Pakistan, what more do you need? A whole fight broke out on this. Okay. And what do you think the cause of all of this was? What do you think the flaw in all of this? It turns out Pakistan was simply doing better in cricket with any country. In other words, they're not winning against India particularly, they're winning against everyone. So that is a good time as far as that's concerned. But you can see the interpretation of how the interpretation gets tweaked. And you're claiming a causality, that six had an impact on India-Pakistan relationships according to this theory. So you're tweaking statistics for your own policy purposes. Okay. So a couple of more fun examples just to wrap this up. So I'm going to give you a plot here where I tell you that on my x-axis, and once again x is on the x-axis, why not put y there, right? So if x is on the x-axis, let's say it's the number of crimes per city per year in different cities. So each point is a city. And we are looking at the number of crimes per city per year. What do you think y is? So you can immediately see how dangerous that this analysis can get. So do criminals go to temples? Or do people who go to temples cause crimes? That's what happens to you if you're going to infer a causality here. So at best, you can hope for a correlation. And even that correlation intuitively is troubling to us, right? So why are we looking at a correlation between this pair of variables? What's the resolution to this? What's the explanation for this plot? This is a plot. This is how the data will look like for different cities. So there's nothing wrong with this. One can statistically prove that this line is indeed a good proper straight line with a non-zero slope. What's the explanation for this? The population. So actually what they should have been measuring is the number of crimes per population of that city. The number of temples. You have a larger population, you'll have more crimes and more temples to deal with that larger population. Okay. So the inherent problem here is there was a third variable which had been ignored from this analysis, which could have better explained everything. So that's again a practical problem in research. Are you looking at the right variables? Supposing you had included population as a third variable, this relationship would have worked out with X being related to population and Y being related to population. No problems with interpretation. But now you can see how troubling your interpretation gets. Okay? And this is statistically sound as a regression. You can do tests to prove that X is related to Y. But that's what happens in social policy making. You collect hundreds of variables, that gapminder link I gave you. There's hundreds of columns of data available to me and I look for relationships. And then I'll get a relationship like this. Now, who is to say that this relationship is invalid? Of course, now I'm going to an extreme and giving you a pair of variables to provoke you, but how do you know? Okay. So a final point to this, is each measurement relevant to you? And this is another standard problem with our research. We tend to throw out we tend to throw out measurements that we do not care for. So we'll tend to think that this was something bad we did in our experimentation. So let's quickly hide that measurement before somebody sees it and pretend that we never did that experiment. Right? That's very standard behavior. But for instance, that could have been a very influential point, which actually leads you to believe that it's no longer a linear model, but something nonlinear happening to you. So how do you interpret your data? So you can see there is a systematic need for diagnosing the importance of each and every measurement in your analysis and then evaluating it in the context of a relevant model. So I'll stop you with this, but the last part of my talk would have been how all of these issues impact the actual publication of results in the published literature.